celebrate Sal for coming to the ending of the kind of this month program with the presentations. This is actually the last presentation. There's always a moment to be first, and there's no moment to be last, right? So this is no coincidence. So please.
Thank you. Well, I'm very happy to be with this group. I love this group. I feel like I'm in kindred spirits. What I want to talk about is, let's use massive, open, online intervention, MOONIES, to prevent depression worldwide. I want you to travel back in time with me to September 1972. The place is Eugene, Oregon. University of Oregon. I just arrived there. I'm 22 years old. I just arrived to begin my doctorate program in clinical psychology. Now, the reason I'm there is because I want to become a therapist. I want to come back to San Francisco, which is where I immigrated, and open up an office to treat Latinos in Spanish. And that's my reason for being there. One of the first courses I take is called Community Psychology. And they assigned me to go to a community mental health center board meeting at which a psychologist named Richard Ingram gives an impassioned talk about primary prevention. I have never heard the term before. I'm sitting there, and what he does is he chides those of us around the room, psychologists, psychiatrists, social workers, and says to us, you know, you sit there in your offices and you wait until people suffer enough for them to have to come to see you. What you ought to be doing is going out into the community and sharing what you know about mental health so that people don't have to suffer enough to come to see you. Now here I am, just about to start this 5-year program to become a therapist, and this man is telling me that that isn't enough. You know, and you can imagine how I was thinking, and I could have gone a couple of ways. I could have just dismissed it. What happened is I had a conversion experience. I mean, his message was so compelling that it made sense. Why not prevent these disorders? Now, I had just come from Stanford. My senior thesis advisor was Albert Bandura. Social learning theory, self-efficacy, personal agency, all these things. You learn from your social environment, how you think, how you behave, even how you feel. Right? So the idea of teaching people these things to prevent disorders made perfect sense to me within that theoretical framework. So what I decided is to try to spend about half of my professional time on prevention and half on treatment. So I sought out professors who were interested in prevention. Jim Kelly was teaching at Oregon at the time. And this was my first publication, Prevention of Mental Disorders. 1975, I was 25 years old, and there was a section in there about prevention of depression. I did my dissertation with Peter Lewinson, who's one of the pioneers on behavioral approaches to depression, and we published this book, which it was a randomized control trial. The dissertation was a randomized control trial looking at pleasant activities, increasing pleasant activities, increasing interpersonal skills, and changing cognitions. We put the protocols of the dissertation to this book, which Pim has actually translated into Dutch and translated into other languages as well. So here I was already trying by putting this into a book to share this knowledge with people, you know, not just professionals but lay people as well. 6 days after I finished at Oregon, I began working at San Francisco General Hospital. My office is on the 7th floor. I had my 38th anniversary September the 6th year. And this is the view from my window. This is the Mission District, the Latino barrio in San Francisco, which is where I grew up after I immigrated at age 10. So for 38 years I've been serving the community in which I grew up. Now I tried to do prevention trials with an NIMH funding, but my grants ended and were not renewed. I had to go back to do my treatment. I founded a depression clinic, which we ran for 10 years, providing individual and group cognitive behavioral therapy in Spanish and English at no charge to primary care patients. And the way I was able to get away with not charging them was by supervising psychiatry residents, psychology interns, and postdocs. At the end of the 10 years, the hospital decided it was such a good thing to have for patients there that they took over the clinic, which was wonderful. the last 20 years. So we just had our 30th anniversary of this clinic. But I'm no longer in charge of this clinic, which is good because I was able to get back to prevention. Now, one of the things that was happening is that the field was saying we couldn't do this, right? This is the National Institute of Mental Health. 1984, they published this in which they say the onset of a clinical depression cannot be prevented. This was the wisdom, the professional wisdom of the field at the time. And so what I tried to do is I tried to see how to change this truth by doing work. Research first on prevention of depression and trying to understand what it was that we needed to do to change that statement. Right? I was lucky enough, partly because of the work I had been doing on this, to be named to the two committees that the Institute of Medicine had on prevention of mental disorders, one in 1994 and one in 2009. And there was one other person who served on both of these, Bill Beardsley, who many of you know, psychiatrist from Harvard. And in 2012, we published this paper in the American Psychologist. Major depression can be prevented, damn it. The editor took out the last word, but that's so Bill and I and Jan Leiking, who was a postdoc with me and is now on the faculty at Palo Alto University too. So moving toward movies then. I had been doing online randomized controlled trials on smoking cessation, and at the end of the grant period, I had to decide whether to shut down the site or not, and I just couldn't bear shutting down the site. It was getting a good quit rate, comparable to that of nicotine patch. And so I was able to get a donation to keep the site going, and we morphed the site. We adapted it to a participant preference site, which meant that anybody who came in could pick any of the elements that we had used in the randomized control trials. The only requirement, the only eligibility criteria was that they had to be 18 years of age. And that was because the IRB, the Institutional Review Board, would not allow us to consent minors, unless we got consent from both the mother and the father. And I have no idea how you do that, especially in a worldwide study. So we just published this a couple months ago. Massive open online interventions, a novel model for delivering behavioral health services worldwide. And what I wanted to do today is give you some ideas why I think this might be a way of preventing depression worldwide. I mean, we're the global consortium, after all, right? We should be doing global studies. So, MUIs, pronounced MUIs, like muy bueno, muy bueno. And Phil just told me that MUI means
beautiful.
I have no idea. Sounds great. Okay, this is basically inspired after massive open online courses. You've heard of MOOCs, massive open online courses, right? Let me go back here for a second. Now, there you go. One of the reasons that I was interested in doing this is because in our smoking cessation internet studies, little by little, we were getting more and more people from throughout the world. The darker the country, the more people who were coming into this site. And so this is what, I mean, I didn't plan this, I just found out as I was doing the study that you could do this. We began the study in 1997. Now it's no surprise to anybody, but in 1997, it was still fairly new. So we had almost 300,000 people come to this participant reference site, right, from almost every country in the world. And out of those, we were able to give everybody who landed on this first page a stop smoking guide, an evidence-based stop smoking guide that has a 10% quit rate that we've shown, right? So if everybody downloaded, and I don't know if everybody did, but if everybody downloaded and used it, we might have helped 30,000 people with smoking, right? At least the potential is there. In eligibility, 18 years of age, a lot of people were less than 18, and they couldn't enter the study. I'll mention more about that. But the idea of MUIs, like MOOCs, is that they would be open to anyone globally. They would ideally be free to hundreds of thousands of participants, and we could do this because these would be self-help automated, and thus not consumable. Because they don't require a person on the other end. These are not guided interventions, which do require somebody at the other end. It's totally self-help automated, okay? Now, this thing about it being ideally free is really important to me. Right? I believe knowledge is this kind of thing that when you give it away, you don't have any less.
Yeah.
Right? And so, thus, we should be giving it away. I mean, I benefited so much from the educational system in California. The work I do should go back to the people, but not just in California, right? Why not share it everywhere? They say patriotism is a wonderful thing, but why should it stop at the border? Okay, so what ideally preach? Depression prevention and intervention should be freely available to the world. You've probably run across this quote from Jonas Salk, who asked who owned the patent on his vaccine against polio, said that people, I would say, there is no patent. Could you patent the sun? Now, I find this very inspiring, so I want you to actually hear him say this. Now, he was dealing with a polio epidemic, right? I mean, imagine this. Imagine your child like this, right? Imagine your child like this. Depression causes this kind of suffering, but it's not visible, right? We know that depression causes a great emotional suffering. Now, they did the March of Dimes. I don't think you can do a March of Dimes for this. We need to come up with some other ways of sustaining this kind of approach. And of course, what's going to eventually happen is that we will need to do this as a group. I mean, you know, he gets the credit for a lot of this. Obviously, he was working with teens. But if his work is used worldwide, why not use our work worldwide? Now, he got the credit, as you know, Ding Dan, it's named after him. I think now we'll be doing it as a thank you. As a group, right? We would crowdsource the interventions, the dissemination, all of that. Okay, so what I want you to do is to, rather than ask whether this can be done, which yields a yes or no answer, I want you to think about how it could be done, right? And that yields inexhaustible multiple paths, right? There's a lot of ways we could do this. So, first, one of the problems with MOOCs, as well as MOOCs, is attrition, right? We know this, right? MIT, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, has this course, this MOOC, 155,000 people registered. Only 7,175 passed the course. That's 4.6%, right? If you were doing a randomized controlled trial and you got 4.6% follow-up rates, would you be disappointed? Well, probably. But one of the people involved with this course said, if you look at the number in absolute terms, it's as many students as might take the course in 40 years at MIT. Right? So we should say 7,000 passed the course, right? I mean, that is something to yell about, right? Well, in our study, in our participant preference trial, we had a great attrition too, but we actually had data on almost 2,500 smokers who gave us data saying they had quit. Right? So, to help that many smokers quit, it would have taken over $3.5 million worth of nicotine patches. A nicotine patch was about $3 in the U.S. You need to use it for 10 weeks. So that's, you know, that's what, 3 times 7, that's 10, that's 110. And then only 20% of people quit, right? So you know, anyway, trust me, it would have taken as much money, 3.5 million and 70 years of a counselor working full time. We were able to do this in 2.5 years for about 200,000. And the reason we were able to do it for that small amount of money, relatively speaking, is because the site was already out, it was already running, and we got a grant to pay for the development and stuff, so we didn't have, all we had to do is keep it hosted. Now, another barrier is consent. Of those eligible, only about half of the people in Spanish and English gave us consent. That means that half of these people who wanted to do this didn't get to do it because they wouldn't sign consent. So one of the things we're doing now is, why not let people who don't consent use the site? It doesn't cost us anything extra. It's just automated, right? So in our study now at I4Help, which is the Institute for International Internet Interventions for Health at Palo Alto University, which is where I am now. In our studies, we give people this choice. So the first one says, I give consent to have my data be included in official research reports. And the other one says, I want to continue using this site, but I do not give consent. Do not include my data in official research reports of the study. So we flag those data, and we don't use them for, you know, for research, but we allow people to use this. If it's going to be helpful to them, why not let it happen?
Okay, can I ask you something about this?
Sure.
Because in ordinary patient care, if you use anonymized data that you collect anyway during treatment, you don't even have to ask them, I think.
No. IRB, you know, did ask us for consent, but
all IRBs are open chat, they can raise their arguments. You said that for God's sake, why would we get in the way of allowing people to get something that's no potential downside? Just because of precious stuff.
How many people ask yes and how many people no?
I don't have those figures, but I don't have the figures. Yeah.
Can you do the same for under 18s?
Pardon?
Can you allow folks under 18 to go in if they are?
That's a good question. IRB still ask us for the deal over 18. Okay, I'm going to share now some work from Jan Lakin, who we just recruited to Palo Alto University. He's been doing internet screening and intervention for depression. This study is called the Mood Screener, and he's been doing searches for depression online. So we have a free mood and depression screener. He's been doing this in 5 languages, so English, Arabic, Chinese, Spanish, and Russian. Okay? And he's got people from pretty much every country and territory forthcoming with those 5 languages only. Now, his only eligibility criteria again is you have to be 18 or older, right? And look at it, how late is it for you here? Look at the percentage of people who are under 18 who want to use this, but we don't let them because they are not adults. Right? We gotta solve this one somehow. And let's talk about that. Depression is Kiatsuma's suicide. Okay, in the past 2 weeks, look at this. The number who screen positive for depression using a mood screener that has the 9 symptoms in the food. The proportion to meet criteria is so high. And then these are the people who say they had a suicide attempt in the past 2 weeks. 10 to 20%. Now, you'd think these people should be getting treatment, right? Now let's look at how many are. Current depression, people with current depression, how many are getting antidepressants or psychotherapy? Again, 10 to 20%. So about 80% of the people, 90% of the people are doing nothing when they come to the site. How about those who are likely or very likely to commit suicide in the next day? Not much better. Right? We need to let people like these have access to our interventions. Right? There's a great need here. We don't have to worry about taking
therapist. Have you shown these data to your IRB? What else are they protecting you from?
Okay, so what, this is a call for action. Right? What we need to do is fill in this grid of movies in which the columns are health problems, the language, the rows are languages. And of course, it would be an ever-growing grid, right? It would never end. You could think of a fourth dimension, which would be gender, age, education, socioeconomic status. You know? Anyway, we need to be doing this. And obviously, our group is focused on this one. And what is it likely that we would be able to do? I think these are about the maximum we might be able to get. About a third of the people might go back to normal, about a third would improve, and a third would have no effect. This is just kind of, you know, off the top of my head kind of thing. This is about what we might be able to do at best. How about prevention? We've talked about how we probably reduce incidence by half at best. Right? It would take us a while maybe to get there, but I think this is a good goal to shoot for. So what are our options in terms of doing this? What I'm suggesting is that we begin with MUIs, who are just self about automated as a basic level of care for everybody in the world. And then you would add to that MUIs with tools that can be used by local helpers, family members, relatives, religious leaders, etc. Who could use, for example, the MUIs that might be able to provide access to them to tablets or laptops, etc. for people who don't have access to them. And who would help people adhere to the MUIs, right? Because we know adherence is a big problem, especially with cell phone automated apps. For localities that have the money, this should provide guided interventions. So Tim has done a lot of work showing that this is better than this, right? This is more effective. But not every locality has the money to do that, right? And then we should also go into health and mental health services, in which the MUIs would be adjuncts. Adriana Guerrera, who's one of the members of our group, is doing text messaging as an adjunct to CBT for depression at San Francisco General Hospital in Spanish and English. The Spanish-speaking patients love it. They feel much more cared for, even though we tell them that the text messages are being generated automatically. Obviously, we eventually need to go to mental health specialty services. We need to do primary care, screening, and treatment. Community outreach using mass media outreach so that people can actually identify themselves as in need of care. And then eventually something like the Odin Project. The Odin Project is the Outcomes of Depression International Network. Norway is part, has been part of that. Pim, I think you're part of that group, right? And what they do is they go house to house, knock on doors, and ask people if they will allow themselves to be screened. Right, for depression in this case. And if they are positive for depression, they offer them treatment, including treatment in their own homes. Now, it's unlikely that this is going to be happening worldwide, right? It's very expensive. So that would be kind of a Cadillac, right? The Tesla. I think we should have this as the basis, right? The higher tier, the greater the cost, but the lower the greater number of people help. And MUIs would be a basic level of care. MUIs alone would be self-help automated. Again, we would have MUIs with local helpers. We would build it in somehow so a local helper could be involved. Paid coaches who are trained, and then as adjuncts to traditional healthcare. So the MUIs would be like this little baby blanket that would be stretched over all the world. And places that have the money to provide face-to-face and live services would still be able to provide it. I'm not saying we should replace these with MUIs. That's not my intent at all. It's just that we need to have it available where there are no services like this. Places that have money to provide guided adjuncts should do so, and places that can do everything, they should do everything. But then there would be no gaps. Places which have no clinics, which have no money for guided adjuncts, would still have the MUI available there. Accessible at no charge. Now, why is focus on worldwide stuff? Partly it's because I didn't grow up there, I grew up here. I grew up in Peru, in a town called Chosica, near Lima, 40 kilometers east of Lima. This is what Chosica looks like. It's a barren area. The coast of Peru is a desert. This is the foothills of the Andes. No vegetation, really totally barren. The only life-giving element here is the river, the Rio Rímac, R-I-M-E-C. And when I was 10, my mother sat me down and said, your father finished primary school, I finished high school, we want our kids to go to university, but we don't have the money to send you there. So your father has decided to go to the U.S. so you can have a good education, and when you finish, we'll come back to Peru to share what you learned. Like many immigrants, we haven't gone back to Peru, but through the internet, I have been sharing what I've learned. I got an email from somebody there asking me if I was the Ricardo Munoz who went there to see my institution. So I reached Chosica. And this picture also reminds me that the internet is kind of like a river, right? A river of information, or in our case, of interventions. And I'm not talking about health information. That's like WebMD, right? I'm talking about health interventions, right? And we want the water to be pure. We want the interventions to be evidence-based, right? And hopefully not harmful. So we can reach towns like this There are thousands of towns like this all over the world. Right? We could do this. This is doable, totally doable. We could blanket the world with movies so we can help as many people.